Is it a family controlled by a crime family engaged in criminal enterprise? Is that what North Korea is? Well, that's what one Republican congressman described it as. And it seems like they have lost their mind. And that young fellow in charge of North Korea seems to be absolutely insane. But nevertheless, he's making a lot of noise. And that country is warning the world it will never give up its nuclear program. And that comes after threatening to attack both South Korea and the United States.
But as the United States and South Korea aren't backing down, who knows what to expect from all of that? Charlene Israel has the story.
North Korea's latest statement that it is at war with South Korea is being taken seriously by the U.S. North Korean officials warn that nuclear weapons are the nation's life and will not be traded even for billions of dollars. The comments came after North Korean leader Kim Jong-un called on his top officials for a stronger economy and nuclear arsenal, and amid increased threats from Pyongyang. Those threats include a vow to launch nuclear strikes on the U.S. and a warning that the Korean Peninsula is now in a state of war. As the threats escalate, the U.S. has joined South Korea in military drills, deploying two F-22 stealth fighter jets this weekend. And just last week, the U.S. sent two nuclear-capable B-2 stealth bombers on a training flight near the North Korean border. Tensions on the Korean Peninsula have been mounting since the U.N. imposed sanctions over the North's nuclear test earlier this year.
We have a range of options to counter their provocations and threats. Obviously, we hope never to have to put those plans into effect.
Even as the White House and Pentagon hope to diffuse escalating animosity, analysts say a full-scale conflict is very unlikely.
As far as I see, this is not even a government. It's really like an organized crime family running a territory. They are brutal. He is brutal. His father's brutal. His grandfather's brutal.
Charlene Israel, CBN News.
Well, when you look back in history, you find there was a lieutenant colonel named Kim Il-sung who was picked by the Russians to head their little satellite nation, North Korea. And it began to move against its southern neighbors. And then the next thing you know, there was a war. I was over there in the Marines at the time, and others were called up when President Truman asked for military action to stop the takeover of the Korean Peninsula. But if he left Douglas MacArthur alone, MacArthur would have gone to the Yalu River, sealed off that peninsula, and it would have been the end of it. But instead of that, we were afraid. We had so-called doves in Washington who were afraid of some provocation against China and therefore insisted that MacArthur stop military action. And we've gotten ourselves a situation years and years and years later where the people are just being brutalized. And Representative King's got it right. It's like an organized crime family. But Kim Il-sung, then his son, who was a dandy and a playboy who fancied European prostitutes and French wines and so forth while these people were starving. And now this he stepped out of the way or died, and his son takes over, this Kim Jong-il. And he's trying to show that he's as tough as the grandfather and father. And it's just terrible. So, ladies and gentlemen, what will happen? Well, I'm glad that the people in the Pentagon are saying, listen, fellas, we have nuclear capability and we can launch against you some rather horrendous strikes that will take away your entire city and your entire nation if you keep this up. Well, North Korea is the world leader in another shameful category, the persecution of Christians. Lee Webb has more on the story from the CBN newsroom. Here's Lee.
Pat, as you know, Christians are the most widely persecuted religious group in the world. Now, three leading experts have released a book with a story on what North Korea and other nations are doing to believers. Here's Dale Hurd.
Layla Gilbert, Paul Marshall, and Nina Shea have written Persecuted, The Global Assault on Christians. The book chronicles the patterns of repression, abuse, and violence against believers. It's no surprise that one of the worst areas for Christians is the Muslim world, made even worse by the so-called Arab Spring. The authors say the most repressive single country in the world for Christians is North Korea.
We have cases that we discuss in our book about North Koreans being shot, summarily executed for being found in possession of a Bible.
But the deadliest nation for Christians last year was Nigeria, where thousands died at the hands of Muslim terrorists.
Last Easter, of course, a series of churches were bombed, full of worshipers. And this has happened repeatedly, over and over again.
The authors blame the current political correct culture for caring less and less about the plight of Christians.
What we used to call witnessing as Christians or evangelizing is now called proselytizing, and it's become a dirty word.
And the authors blame both the Obama and Bush administrations for turning a deaf ear to the plight of Christians in Iraq and Afghanistan.
And the Bush administration, two-thirds of the Christians of Iraq were driven out. And we have it in the book about some conversations we had with Secretary Rice at the time, saying, you know, please speak up for them. And she said, no, we cannot get involved in sectarian affairs.
Paul Marshall warned that democracy building will ultimately fail without the protection of religious liberty.
Religious freedom is regarded as something on the side. It's what you do on Sunday. But if you don't have religious freedom, you will not have democratic development in any country in the world.
Dale Hurd, CBN News.
Israel has started making its first natural gas deliveries from an offshore facility. Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu says it marks what he calls an important day for Israel's economy, and it should provide the country with a reliable energy source. Israel uses natural gas to generate about 40% of its electricity, Pat.
Well, you know, it's very encouraging where an American company has discovered a vast, and I use the term advisedly, a vast natural gas field off the coast of Israel in the Mediterranean. And once that thing is fully developed and comes online, not only will it take care of all of Israel's need for natural gas, it will also give them something probably to export. So it'll be a major game changer for the whole Israeli nation. And so I'm delighted that they've begun to take deliveries of natural gas. It will be a game changer. Lee?
Pat, an oil pipeline spill in Arkansas could keep some people out of their homes there for weeks. ExxonMobil says more than 12,000 barrels of oil and water have been recovered since the pipeline ruptured Friday. That spill could play a role in the politics surrounding the Keystone XL pipeline project. Environmentalists are against that project because of the risk of spills like the one in Arkansas. But the government says using pipelines releases less pollution than shipping oil by rail. There is new momentum in the campaign to end a long-standing and illegal practice in India: aborting unborn baby girls. Heather Sells has that story.
For centuries, Indian women and girls have endured many types of abuse. Now, the death of a university student after a brutal gang rape is stirring a new national conversation about women's rights. The outrage may even be affecting the rights of unborn females. Recently, the government announced steps to stop gender-based abortion, which kills about 7,000 unborn girls a day in India. It's a tragedy that Dr. Prakash Tyagi sees regularly.
The ultrasound technology has reached most parts of the country. It has become more affordable, more accessible, and it has definitely fueled the whole sex-selective abortion scenario.
On paper, this practice is illegal. But social forces demand it. That's because in many homes, girls are seen as an economic liability.
Girls are considered to be a burden on families, and boys are considered to be the producers of the family, the ones who are going to work for family, the ones who are going to bring incomes.
26-year-old Kavina's story is common. Several years ago, she had an abortion, although she did not want it.
I already had a son, but then I became pregnant again and discovered I was having a girl. The family and village pressure was so much, I had to do it.
Now there's new hope that cultural support for aborting baby girls in the womb may be softening. The government has announced that it's penalizing some of the doctors who perform these gender-based abortions. About 100 doctors will serve up to 5 years in prison The government will also either suspend or cancel their medical license. Heather Sell, CBN News.
A bipartisan group of eight senators is nearly finished with an immigration reform plan. Their proposal would provide a new class of worker visas for low-skilled workers, secure the border, crack down on employers, improve illegal legal immigration, and create a 13-year pathway to citizenship for millions of illegal immigrants already here.
Best of the 11 million, they'll have a pathway to citizenship, but it will be earned, it will be long, and it will be hard, and I think it is fair. And the main thing, the combination of events in this bill will prevent a third wave of illegal immigration and replace a broken immigration with a merit-based, economic-based system to help grow our economy in the future.
Senator Graham says he's confident the bill will pass both houses of Congress. Other lawmakers, though, warn there are still important details to resolve. Well, you may spend a lot of time watching TV, but a new study reports in the London Telegraph says people also spend much of their time just looking for their remote control, more than 5 minutes a week, in fact. That adds up to about 2 weeks and a day over the course of the average lifetime. The study finds that one of the main reasons that remotes get lost is because children hide them. Pat?
Either children or dogs. I'm not sure which. But
your dog eating your remote again?
Yeah, that's right. He ate the remote. We have a huge, just a monstrous remote. It's almost impossible to lose it. If it was a little tiny thing, it would be gone. I mean, I promise you it would be gone.
One would like to think that after one did that a few times, you'd find a specific spot to put it.
You always put it someplace else.
I guess
but
so.
If the little kids are around, they'll take them and hide them, and the dogs will take them and chew them up. You know, I was out reading in my kitchen, and I had papers out there, and I had glasses, and I let the dog into the kitchen. Up on the table when I wasn't there.
Took your glasses.
Got the glasses, started chewing the lenses. I mean, it's not. Pets are terrible things to have, yeah. But we all have them. All right.
Yeah, between the channel changer and the glasses, I think I'd small dog.
This is a small dog, but it doesn't matter. He's big when he comes to getting up on tables.
Edith Schaefer died Saturday at the age of 98. She co-founded the LaBrie Christian Centers with her late husband, Francis Schaefer. She's remembered for her humanity, humility, and hospitality. Edith was born in China to Christian missionaries. In 1935, she married Francis Schaefer, and the two became missionaries to Switzerland. Her many books include The Tapestry, The Life and Times of Francis and Edith Schaefer. CBN's Superbook received a powerful audience response after its first airing in Mexico Saturday. The program ran in 31 states on one of Mexico's top television networks, Cadena Tres, known for its extensive weekend children's programming. Three back-to-back episodes of Superbook were shown, The Miracles of Jesus, The Last Supper, and He is Risen. After the programs, a salvation message was presented and special invitation was given to call CBN Mexico. Callers could receive prayer, take part in a Superbook survey, and receive a devotional. So many callers flooded CBN, many of them received busy signals, so they began sending messages through CBN's website and on Facebook. One of the largest churches in Mexico, Amistad Cristiana, also helped promote the Superbook programs with a special event, including an appearance by Gizmo, a Superbook character. More than 100 salvations have been reported from the programs and the promotion, and more are expected. You can find out more about what CBN is doing around the world by logging on to cbn.com/international.